morning. We are so glad that you are here with us worshiping today. We hope that you find this service a time of meaningful connection, even though we cannot be together. If you are new to this community of faith, maybe you found us online, or maybe a friend invited you to watch the service, we are glad that you are here. This is a place where whoever you are, wherever you are on your faith journey and in your life journey, you are welcome here. If you have recently joined this community of faith online and would like to receive our newsletter, go to uumc.org. That's our website. Find the contact button, fill out the form with your email address, and we would love to add you to that list. We promise never to sell that information. You can also subscribe to our YouTube channel. Below the video, there's a button there that says subscribe. We'd love to have you do that as well. As we enter into this time of worship, may God's Spirit of peace surround you as we worship together today. Let us join together in our call to worship from John 14. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Let us follow Jesus, who is the way. Trust in God. Trust in Jesus, who has gone to prepare a place for us. Let us follow Jesus, who is the way. We know the way to the place where Jesus is. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Let us join together on this journey of faith. Let us follow Jesus, who is the way. And now please join us in singing our opening hymn, For the Beauty of the Earth.
Oh, join in singing I Am the Church as we prepare for children's time. I am the church, you are the church, we are the church together. All who follow Jesus all around the world, yes, we're the church together. The church is not a building, the church is not a steeple, the church is not a resting place, the church is a people. I am the church, you are the church, we are the church together. All who follow Jesus all around the world, yes, we're the church together. Good morning, children. It's great to see you this morning for children's time. I'm so glad that you're here, even though you're not really here, you're out there, but I can still see your smiling faces. So I'm up here in my office. I'm doing all of my my parts of worship from my office. And I'm doing the children's sermon, and I don't have an adorable 2-year-old and 4-year-old handy to help me with the children's sermon this morning. But I do have a grandson who lives out on the West Coast. He lives in a town called Berkeley, which is very, very close to San Francisco. And I'm bringing up a video of him here. And so I can't have him here today, but I want to show you a video. And I want you to watch real closely. See if you can see what's going on in this video. Okay? Watch this. Oh, his name is Rowan, by the way. Okay, could you see what was happening there in the video? So you couldn't see his parents, except at the very end you saw his mom, Shell-In, but they were scrunching up their faces and smiling at him, and then he was imitating them. He was doing it right back to them, right? I mean, this is an important way that babies learn. This is how they learn to talk and walk and do all of the amazing things that human beings can do. They learn by imitating their parents and by imitating other children. I was thinking today, that imitation doesn't stop when we're babies. As teenagers, as young adults, as older adults, we're still learning things by imitating others. And one person that we especially try to imitate and follow in the church is Jesus. When we come into a situation, we try to ask maybe, what would Jesus do in this situation? Would Jesus take time to help this person who needs help, maybe crossing the street or whatever, or would Jesus just turn and walk the other way? Would Jesus hold on to all of his money that he had for himself, or would he maybe give some to help others who are in need? So whatever age we are, wherever we are, even in quarantine, we're still learning from Jesus how to be more compassionate, how to be more loving, how to be more caring, how to be a really good neighbor. And so we're thankful for the example that he set. Will you have a prayer with me? Let's pray. Dear God, we are so thankful for Jesus. We're thankful that we can learn from him how to be better people, how to love and be kind and compassionate. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Our scripture reading today comes from the book of John, chapter 14, verses 1 through 7. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In God's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Jesus, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. If you know me, you will know God also. From now on, you've seen God and you served God.
The grace, mercy, and peace of God be with you all. Amen. Many years ago, the United Methodist Church decided to revise our hymn book. You know, that big red book that we used to sing out of in the pews? Well, the committee sent around surveys to learn about favorite hymns. And there was one hymn that made the list of the most and the least popular. Any guesses? Yes, someone in the back there? Yes, you're right. How Great Thou Art. It's one of those hymns where there's little middle ground. You either love it, or you'd be okay if you never heard it again in your life. Now, I think something like that is at work in the larger church with this text that we read from John's Gospel. John 14, verse 6. No one can come to the Father except through me. This verse either defines your faith, or you find it so offensive you would like to cut it out of the Bible with scissors, just like Thomas Jefferson. So much evil has been done in the name of this verse, crusades and pogroms and misguided missionary efforts. I wonder if John at times might have done better to just leave that verse on the cutting floor. It seems so out of character with a Jesus whose arms are always spread wide open, welcoming everyone. So when these puzzles pop up in the Bible, you know my counsel by now. If it doesn't make sense, keep wrestling with it until it does. And maybe you'll also find a blessing. So this morning I want to offer a couple of ways to understand why Jesus would say something like this. And then I want to take it all a step further. Okay, you ready? Here we go. First thing, Jesus and the church that followed him were up against a powerful religious culture, the Roman Empire, the rituals and deities of Rome. And those early Christian practitioners who were following Jesus, they were intent on defining themselves over against Rome. Rome's ways depended on ruthless power and violence and exploitation of the poor. So if you are worshiping in their temples, then what you're saying is you support that. So what Jesus is saying here is, there's the way that all of you see out there every day, Caesar's way. And then there's my way. And my way leads to life. So another thing, and there's also a sense in the Gospels that time is of the essence, that the end of civilization, or maybe even the end of the world, is right around the corner. And I often have described this as just like the last few seconds of a basketball game, where you're down by 1 point, and you're huddled up together in a timeout, and the coach says, so what do you guys think we ought to do right now? Or maybe she says, okay guys, here are 3 plays. You pick one of them and go out there and go get them. No, I mean, the coach doesn't say that. The coach says, here's the plan. You set a screen and you get the ball to him and then you take the shot. This is a decisive, defining moment for in the basketball game, but it's also a decisive moment for Jesus and for the disciples, making a decision about which way is the way to follow. think we also need to recall who is the one who's saying this. Who says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, right? This is Jesus, who is the friend of sinners. Jesus, who loved to spend time with the very ones who were excluded by the respectable members of the religious establishment. This is the same Jesus who believed that care for hurting human beings was more important than checking off all of the correct religious beliefs. So you might be thinking, okay, Pastor John, if all of this is true, then this means that Jesus is not the only way to God. If it means that there are other ways, then why bother being a Christian at all? Well, Molly Ivins actually gives us the answer to this question. You gotta dance with them what brung ya. Yes, you gotta dance with them what brung ya in marriage, in relationships, even in faith. We know that there are others that we could have married, that we could have partnered up with, but right now, your identity is bound up with the one that you're with the one whom you love with your heart and soul and mind and strength. And that's so for religious faith also. When a disciple says, yes, Jesus, you are the way. That's not a statement of fact or exclusion that only Jesus can save you and no one else. It's a confession of love and loyalty. This is where I find liberation and light and healing. For me, this is such a beautiful way of understanding this verse, and it's so much more liberating than the thick-headed ways that we hear this verse used so often in American Christianity. Now, I think that there's more here in this verse, and I want to take you to that more via a story from another pastor. She's a Lutheran pastor who serves a church in Canada, actually just north of my hometown, Toronto, in Newmarket, Ontario. Pastor Dawn, D-A-W-N, was taking an undergrad course in religious studies. Her classmates were from practically every religious background on the planet. So one day they were given their assignment. They needed to partner up with someone and each of them write about a verse in the other one's religious tradition that they found interesting. So her partner was Nigel, a devout Hindu who was intrigued with this fellow Jesus, as he liked to call him. After several weeks of study, Nigel and Dawn got together and they talked about the texts that they had chosen. Well, Pastor Dawn chose a text from the Upanishads, ancient Hindu scriptures, that talked about how all religions are pathways that eventually lead to the same place, to the divine. Any idea what text her partner chose? Yes, that one. To her horror, Nigel chose John 14, verse 6. No one comes to the Father except through me. Dawn was now imagining failing this class. She was all ready to counter and offer another text from John's gospel, but Nigel interrupted her with an interpretation of John 14, verse 6 that, she said, put her to shame. This verse, he said, is absolutely true. Jesus is the only way. And that way of dying to an old way of being and being born into a new way of being is known in all the religions of the world. The way of Jesus is a universal way, known even to millions who have never heard of Jesus. He went on. This path, this way, is a metaphor for the religious life, the path of dying to an old way and being born and rising into a new way. It's the only way to God. Dying and rising. Not as a future hope in heaven somewhere, somehow, but as a present reality, here and now. Dying and rising. This is the transformation that is at the heart of the Christian faith. We should know this. We are Methodists, for goodness sake. Our mission statement is that we are making disciples for what? For the transformation of the world. And what is that transformation? Surely it is nothing other than when a way of life, when an old system, when an old set of ideas or an old set of habits, when an old way of being church or doing mission in the world or just doing life is left behind, dies, and a new way emerges, a way to healing, a way to hope, and a way to act. So can you think of a time when something old needed to die in you? And it died. And you were raised to new life. If you feel comfortable, feel free to share it in the comment section at the end of the service. Okay, friends, this doesn't need to get all complicated. Let me share a story. A pastor friend shared this with me. So there was a woman in his congregation who really despised him, just didn't care for him at all. He was way too liberal for her. He had had the audacity to take the American flag out of the sanctuary. So she began avoiding him, and he avoided her because every conversation was critical. And so they really stopped speaking to each other. Well, through a surrogate, he learned that she had issued an ultimatum to him. Unless they sang Battle Hymn of the Republic some Sunday in the next 6 weeks, she would leave the congregation. Well, of course, they were a really progressive congregation, and they didn't sing Battle Hymn of the Republic, and she made good on her promise, and she disappeared from the church for several years. Well, word came to the pastor that she was in the hospital and that she was dying. Now, he knew that as a pastor, he was supposed to go see her, but he didn't want to. He really didn't want to. Pastors, you've been there, right? He reasoned that he was the very last person on earth that she would want to see. And so he consulted his wife, and she asked him, "Is your calling only to visit the people that you like?" Appropriately chastened, he left for the hospital. He stopped at the nurse's station to send advance warning that he was there. And the nurse came back and said, "You can go in." He stopped for a moment at the door, and she raised her hand for him to come in. And before he could say anything to her, as he approached the bed, she raised her arms, she wrapped them around his neck, and she kissed him on the cheek. "I am so glad you came," she said. They talked for what seemed like hours. They caught up on everything, even on the church that she had left. And he learned through some friends that she died the next day. Now, for my friend, this was a story of dying and rising to new life, dying to his ego, dying to his hurt feelings and his excuses, and rising into love and compassion for this woman. And I can't imagine that it was any different for her. Jesus says, "I am going to prepare a place for you." And Thomas asks, "We don't know where you're going. How can we know the way?" As we scan the headlines, and as we listen to the news, and as the anxiety rises and folds into a hard lump in our gut, we ask, "What's the way forward? How can we know the way?" Oh, friends, you know the way. You know his way, his life, his arms wide open. You know his love for neighbor. You know his dying and rising. You know that our overwhelming and anxious and awful stories of now will not end in death. They will rise into something new and beautiful and true. His way is open before us, and His way will lead us home. We know the way. So do not let your hearts be troubled, and neither let them be afraid. In the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Please join me in prayer. Mother God, we give you thanks this day for mothers everywhere and for our own mothers. We thank you for those who have joined you in eternity and whom we miss dearly here on earth. We thank you for every woman who is working day and night to raise her children right now. We thank you for all the women who are expecting but aren't quite mothers yet. We thank you for the women who took in others' children through adoption and foster care. We ask your comfort for the women who have lost a child to death and must carry on. May they be sustained and strengthened by your love. We ask your peace for all the women who have desperately longed to have children of their own. We pray today for the mothers who have been unable to be a source of strength, who have not responded to their children, and have not sustained their families. May they grow in their understanding of their calling as mothers. Bless all women who serve as mothers in whatever way that may be. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. And now let us join together praying the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
We are so very grateful for your gifts that keep us going. Each week, so many of you offer not only your time as we watch the service together, but also your financial gifts, which keep us going in a time when nothing is normal. You can give to our church by going to University United Methodist Church and mailing your check, or you can go to uumc.org/give and give online. Thank you so much.
Oh,
With joyful hearts, we offer ourselves and our gifts to God. May our offerings bless those who are in need, who hurt, and who seek hope. Today, I give thanks for our flower ministry team. Throughout this time of being apart, we have not had flowers in our sanctuary. So they have adapted and adjusted, and they are writing notes and sending cards and making phone calls and sending emails to keep us connected in this time. And for all our gifts, we give God thanks. May our offerings be signs of your gifts to the whole world, bringing healing and reconciliation.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below.
We are so glad you joined us for worship this week. We hope that it's been a positive experience for you and that you feel connected both to our community and to God. Your invitation this week is to share our service with someone else you know, someone that might live in the same house as you or someone that lives in another state or another city. If you can hit the like and subscribe on our YouTube channel, that will connect us to many other people. I hope that you'll join us in our closing hymn.
Friends, as we close the service out today, I invite you to stay on and listen to what follows and maybe to comment. And I invite you now to receive these words of benediction and blessing. These are words that have come to have greater meaning to me during this time. Life is short, and we do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who make this journey with us. So be swift to love. And make haste to be kind. And may the blessing of God, Creator, Redeemer, and Spirit be with you now and always. Amen.